بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. Dear viewers, this is going to be an extremely sensitive episode in this series of the mawqif or not the mawqif, and within this series, the series of al-jarh wa-ta'dil. We're going to bring you today recordings of what certain scholars have said about Shaykh Rabee ibn Hadi al-Madkhali. And these scholars are none other than Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala and Shaykh Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad hafidhahullah ta'ala. And this episode is very likely to be unpleasant to an awful lot of people, be it the people who fanatically ally to the cause of Shaykh Rabee or the people who fanatically oppose Shaykh Rabee. And we live in a day and age where the Muslim Ummah goes through so much turmoil and the entire world goes through so much turmoil. We woke up a few days ago to what's going on Netflix with this new disgusting series that's out there. That is just a reflection of the magnitude of complexity and distancing and how far away human minds have gone away from the fitrah. And the more complex our environment becomes, the more people are going to disagree. And this is why it's key for any Muslim who wants to survive in this crazy, over-agitated sea where the waves of fitan keep on bashing each other back and forth relentlessly, you need to learn how to deal with disagreement and stay away from fanaticism and have the Quran and the Sunnah as your absolute safe base to go back to. And I would like to introduce what follows with a quote by Imam al-Shawkani rahimahullah ta'ala that I found in this book, which is called Tawdih Usul al-Fiqh ala Manhaj Ahl al-Hadith, by an author that I did not know before, who is Zakaria ibn Ghulam Qadir al-Pakistani. And it's a book that I bought by mistake, and alhamdulillah, that was a blessed mistake of mine. Because so far I've only been extremely highly impressed by this book, because it's full of quotes by our a'imma on matters of usul al-fiqh. So here the author made a chapter on the obligation of taking a text with its apparent meaning and not reinterpreting it, going beyond bounds, trying to get some far-fetched interpretation of a clear text just in order to justify what your jama'ah is upon, be it the matter in aqidah or other. But obviously this is very widespread in aqidah, and this is how we got to these claims of al-majaz in Arabic, which we could translate as metaphorical speech. So let me quote to you what Imam al-Shawkani has said in the book Muntaha al-Arb fi Adab al-Talab. So he said, وَكَثِيرًا مَا تَجِدُ الْمُتَعَصِّبِينَ يُحَامُونَ عَنْ مَذَاهِبِهِمْ وَيُؤَثِّرُونَهَا عَلَىٰ النُّصُوصِ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. So it is very common to see the mutaassibin, the people who have taken party to a madhab. Right, and as I always repeat, people, a madhab is not only the four madhahib of fiqh. A madhab is what you're upon. Your opinion on something is your madhab on this thing. When a scholar tells you, this particular issue, I believe that it's 1, 2, 3, then 1, 2, 3, that's his madhab on this. So he says that we find that the people who are staunch followers of these madhahib, they try to protect their madhab at any cost, and they give precedence to their madhab upon the text of the Quran and the Sunnah. فإذا جاءهم نص لا يجدون عنه متحولا أعياهم رده وأعجزهم دفعه. So whenever they have a nas, now the word nas in usul al-fiqh, that is a text that is unquestionable in the sense of its meaning. It is further than ظاهر. ظاهر النص, يعني ظاهر النص, yeah, it means that, you know, the text really seems to be saying something, and there is a slight possibility that something else could be implied by this text. So we have to look for other indications that could possibly indicate that something else is implied. However, a nas, that's something where there is absolutely no room for messing about and reinterpreting anything. So it says when these people, when there is a nas that comes to them, that they just can't mess with. It's just clear cut. There is no way that you're going to change that meaning or claim anything else. Then they ادعوا أنه مجاز وذكروا للتجوز علاقة هي من البعد بمكان وقرينة ليس لها في ذلك المقام وجود ولا تدعو إليها الحاجة. So when they're in such a situation, they claim that this is metaphorical speech. And in order to justify metaphorical speech, they have to look for what is called a علاقة. It means a connection between this particular text and what would allow them to claim that there is a metaphor. And Imam al-Shawkani says, but this connection, من البعد بمكان, is extremely far-fetched and absolutely not justifiable. So what I want you to understand is that this is a common attitude amongst human beings, because it's extremely hard to accept the truth if it goes against your own framework. Because the area that you feel safe in, right, you might have grown up in this, or if you're a convert like me, you might have gone through very troublesome times, and then you found, you know, a group of people that claim Salafiyya and that had many attributes of Salafiyya, right, and following the Sunnah, and you have attached yourself to this group. And that's extremely dangerous. When you're attached to Zayd and Ubaid instead of Allah, His Messenger, and the Book of Allah. Alright, and this is from Al-Ibtila. Right, if you meditate on the meanings of the Qur'an, especially in Surah Al-Baqarah, when, you know, the Qibla was changed, the type of Ibtila that was, well, there are quite some parallels to take between these kind of scenarios and the scenarios that every Muslim has to go through when he just wakes up to the plain truth that, hey, there is something wrong with what I'm doing, or there is something wrong with what my crew asks me to do. Okay. So, in our particular context, we're going to look at, first of all, a recording of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. It's a question that's being asked to him about something that was contemporary. So this must have been more than 20 years ago, folks. All right, Sheikh al-Uthaymeen, he died approximately 20 years ago. So this was maybe around the 25, 30 years ago that this happened. So let's listen to the question.
البارحة تكلمت معكم ولدي بعض الأسئلة. يا شيخ أنت تعلم يعني ماذا يجري الآن من فتنة بين أهل السنة في هذه البلاد خاصة، يعني وهذا الأمر تحول عندنا إلى أمر خطير، حتى أنه كثير من المساجد تفرق الأخوة فيها. فلدي سؤال، السؤال الأول يا شيخ، إذا اختلف بعض العلماء وبعض الدعاة في تجريح بعض الدعاة في تجريح شخص أو تعديل، يعني بعض الدعاة عدل والبعض الآخر جرح، هل يلزم من ذلك تجريح من عدل؟
So please understand what the questioner is asking about here. He's not asking that when you have individual scholar A saying Sunnah, scholar B saying Bid'ah, he's not even asking whether automatically, as scholar B said bid'ah, that khalas, this guy is written off. No, it goes further. is even scholar A to be written off because he hasn't declared the bid'ah or the jarh. Alright, so this is tasalsul fi tabdi', chain tabdi'. Alright, you not down with our tabdi', you're out, even if you're a scholar. Okay, and then obviously the chain goes on now, because then you layman, if you do not accept that this scholar A is a mubtadi', because he declared the individual to be a mubtadi', then now you're also on that ruling, etc. So let's see what the Shaykh has to say.
هل يلزم من ذلك تجريح من عدل؟
لا
ما يلزم من ذلك. طيب شيخ
لا يلزم
نحن
لأن الذي عدل
نعم
عدل على حسب اعتقاده
نعم
وأن أصاب له أجر وأن أخطأ له أجر
نعم ولكن هو الذي عدل ما يلزم أننا نجرحه
شيخ لك لا
نعم
لا يلزم
نعم شيخ.
So people, why did the Shaykh not say that it's binding? What has he explained? In asaba falahu ajran wa in akhta falahu ajr. If he gets it right, he gets two rewards, and if he gets it wrong, he gets one reward. What are these matters? That's the hadith is that idha ijtahada al-hakim. So this is a matter of ijtihad. These matters of declaring somebody an innovator, those are matters of ijtihad, as I have been repeating all over. Let's continue.
طيب نحن الآن شيخ نمر بمرحلة أن كثير من المساجد الآن الإخوة أصبحوا يطلقوا علينا يعني أننا مبتدعة وأننا ضلال لأننا لم يعني نبدع من أرادوا أن يبدعوه أو يجرحوا من أرادوا أن يجرحوه.
So if you don't make تبديع of the ones that we make تبديع of, we make تبديع of you. Sounds familiar?
قال هذا نعم
شيخ؟ إن كان ما قلته حقا
نعم
فهؤلاء اتبعوا أهواءهم.
بارك الله فيك يا شيخ.
المسائل الاجتهادية
نعم
المسائل الاجتهادية ما يجرح فيها الإنسان إلا إذا خالف السلف
نعم. القضية هي متعلقة في عين رجل شيخ وهو أتصور تعريفه الشيخ عدنان عرعور.
نعم
فهل
فأنا أقول بارك الله فيك
نعم
لا يحل لنا
نعم
أن نجعل أشخاصا رموزا
نعم
نوالي من ولاهم ونوالي من عداهم
نعم
هذا غلط عظيم
شيخ. طيب هل نحن لدينا دورة
لا الإنسان يخطئ ويصيب
نعم.
So people, let's take a close look at what happened here. Now the individual, which is Adnan Ar'ur, disclaimer, I don't really know what this individual is about. I don't know how the story ended, etc. But what we want to look at here is the attitude of the Sheikh and the underlying principles that govern this attitude. So when the name was said, you could clearly hear from the tone of voice of the Sheikh, he's like, yeah, like, here we go again. That old story. Okay? And the Sheikh didn't go into some wild explanation, okay, of what some people want to say, that he has to make a rad on the jarh mufassar now. It means that every single point that was held against Adnan Ar'ur, if Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen wants to say that no, he's okay, he has to respond to every single point in there. Well, we see that's not what the Shaykh does. Rather, he goes straight to the real underlying cause of this problem. And that's what he says here. Let's listen to it again.
القضية هي متعلقة في عين رجل شيخ وهو أتصور تعريفه الشيخ عدنان عرعور.
نعم.
فهل تنصح؟
أنا أقول بارك الله فيك.
نعم.
لا يحل لنا
نعم
أن نجعل أشخاصا رموزا
نعم
نوالي من ولاهم ونوالي من عداهم.
نعم.
هذا غلط عظيم
شيخ. طيب هل نحن لدينا دورة
لأن الإنسان يخطئ ويصيب.
So to mawqif or not to mawqif, here is an answer to that question.
شيخ نحن لدينا دورات أحيانا علمية وندعو فيها أمثال الشيخ عدنان, فهل تنصحنا بدعوة الشيخ عدنان؟
من قال لك إني أجرح الناس؟
أنا ما قلت أنك
تجرح. سؤال, هذا غلط منك.
لا أنا أسألك.
هل أنا أقول للناس لا ما تدعون فلان ولا تدعون فلان.
لا أنا أسألك حتى لأنه بعض
ولا قبل الحق ولا من الشيطان. تعرف الشيطان ولا تعرف؟
نعم شيخ نعم حديث أبي هريرة. نعم
شيخ بي.
شيخ نحن أنا أسأل هذا السؤال لأنه بعض الأخوة في مناطق أخرى قالوا أنكم تجرحون الرجل ولا تنصحون باستدعائه واستخدامه لإلقاء محاضرات ودروس. هل هذا صحيح؟
هذا كذب علينا.
بارك الله فيك.
وما أكثر ما يكذب علينا.
بارك الله فيك يا شيخ. وهذا ظننا بكم.
Can you believe it? Sheikh Al Uthaymeen says that you can take knowledge from somebody who Sheikh Rabee declared to be an innovator.
والسؤال الثالث شيخ وهو مسألة يعني مسألة التحاكم بين الشيخ ربيع والشيخ عدنان. لماذا يا شيخ ما تحكموا أنتم في هذه المسألة ونرتاح من هذه الفتنة العظيمة؟
Alright, so here you hear that the name of the Imam al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, the person who according to many people cannot be rejected. Any Jarh Mufassar that comes from him has the same status as the Ayah of the Quran and the Hadith Sahih of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is binding upon the Ummah and it has to be applied by everybody. Okay, so we see that Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he doesn't seem to be thinking like that. He didn't say, oh dear, Sheikh Rabee said so. Oh, no. I recount everything I said and khalas, just go by it. No, Sheikh al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he had a different approach to it. So clearly, somebody has lied upon the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen for the sake of backing up Shaykh Rabee's program towards Adnan Ar'ur. So that's what's explicitly said here. Now, read in between the lines, who do you think that could have been? What category of people might be behind that? The second recording is by a Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala. Let's listen to the question.
هذا السؤال نطرحه لكي يعني يسجل وينتشر كما انتشر ضده. فضيلة الشيخ ظهرت شائعة حامل لوائها بعض أصحاب القلوب المريضة يزعمون فيها كذبا أنك طعنت في الشيخ ربيع في درس من دروسك ولا نظن أنهم يقصدون بذلك إلا ضرب العلماء بعضهم ببعض فما قولكم في هذا وما توجيهكم لهؤلاء فنحن نريد أن يؤخذ الشريط وينتشر تبيانا لباطلهم.
So my first comment here is this absolutely shocking and disgusting attitude in asking questions when it comes to matters that they are fanatical about. So a lie is being spread. You're already accusing the other party of being liars. They are the bearers of a flag of fitna. Right, so they are the ones spreading fitna. It's the other party that is blameworthy. They are people of sick hearts, so we have a diagnosis of what's in the chest. And their intention is to make scholars clash. You see, it's unbelievable how these people entitle themselves to pass these kind of judgments on, you know, their level of integrity and their intention just based upon the fact that they disagree with them on a matter. This is absolutely shocking and unacceptable. Second is the fact that when you ask a scholar a question with this kind of language, there are certain scholars that will be intimidated and pull out. And you know, say, oh dear, you know, this is fitna, you know, people are accusing of lying, you know, they pull out. And I'm not going to say any names, but there are certain scholars within the yard or, you know, the camp of these particular people that function like that. Because once I had been commissioned to make a wide announcement on a jarh of a certain individual, who's one of the scholars of Saudi Arabia, And then their own followers, like their own followers, some of them did have inclinations towards this particular scholar. They went complaining to the same sheikh who I got orders from to make that announcement. And, you know, he felt very embarrassed. No, I've never said that. And I never asked him to do anything. Okay, so that's a reality. Anyway, let's listen to what the sheikh has to say in response.
الشيخ ربيع يعني من 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 المشتغلين بالعلم في هذا الزمان وله جهود جيدة وجهود عظيمة يعني في الاشتغال بالسنة وكذلك التأليف له كانت له تأليف جيدة وعظيمة ومفيدة ولكنه في الآونة الأخيرة انشغل في أمور ما كان ينبغي له أن ينشغل بها وكان ينبغي له أن يشتغل بما كان عليه أولا من الجد والاجتهاد يعني في الكتابة المفيدة وفي الآونة الأخيرة يعني حصل منه بعض أمور لا نوافقه عليها ونسأل الله عز وجل أن يوفقنا وإياه لكل خير وأن يوفق الجميع لما تحمد عاقبته وأنا لا أطعن فيه ولا أحذر منه وأقول أنه من العلماء المتمكنين ولو اشتغل بالعلم ويعني جد فيه ولأفاد يعني كثيرا وقبل مدة يعني كانت جهوده أعظم من جهوده في الوقت الحاضر فأنا أعتبر الشيخ ربيع من العلماء الذين يعني يطمئن إليهم وفائدتهم كبيرة ولكن كل يأخذ من قوله ويرد وليس أحد من المعصوم ونحن نخالفه في بعض الأمور التي حصلت لا سيما في هذا الزمان من ما حصل من الفتنة التي انتشرت وعمت وصار طلاب العلم يتهاجرون ويتنازعون ويتخاصمون بسبب ما جرى بينه وبين غيره حيث انقسم الناس إلى قسمين وعمت الفتنة وطمت وكان عليه وعلى غيره أن يتركوا استمرار يعني هذا الذي حصلت فيه الفتنة وأن يتركوا الزيادة والاستمرار يعني في ذلك وأن يشتغل الكل بالعلم النافع دون هذا الذي حصل فيه التفرق وحصل فيه التشتت وأسأل الله عز وجل للجميع التوفيق.
What a beautiful response. Wisdom, balance, fairness, and an effort to get rid of trouble rather than to fuel it. How beautiful. That is the attitude of a alim. And that's something that I respect very highly. Were us little folks to understand the message that Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Hafidhahullah Ta'ala tried to convey, we would spare ourselves an awful lot of trouble with our close surroundings and our wider surroundings in this world. Here again, you clearly see that Sheikh Abdul Muhsin is well aware of what's going on. And to those people who, you know, have these rubbish excuses, like I have mentioned this attitude as described by Imam Shawkani of trying to say, oh, well, he's not specialized in manhaj, oh, he's not well aware, oh, but it's not really what he meant, or like at the beginning of the course, say, oh, but this is not true, the Sheikh didn't say that, when he's on record. People fear Allah. That's really what I want to tell you. And looking back at what of the earlier scholars of this ummah has said about Sheikh Rabi', the scholar is Malik ibn Anas, Imam Udar al-Hijra. Yes, Imam Malik spoke about Sheikh Rabi' ibn Hadi al-Madkhali. Yes, about 1,200 years ago. That's correct. He did speak about Sheikh Rabi' when he said, كل يؤخذ من قوله ويرد إلا صاحب هذا القبر, meaning the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Everybody is accepted from and rejected from, except for the person in this grave, meaning the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Were we to adopt such an attitude, whatever side of the spectrum you are you from the fanatic Muta'asibin of Shaikh Rabee, or are you from the fanatic opponents of Shaikh Rabee? Can we do what Shaykh Muhammad Al-Uthaymeen implied when he said خُذ الْحَقْ وَلَوْ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ in the first video? Why do you think he said that? Huh? Why do you think he said take the truth even if it's from the shaytan, as we have a clear text indicating us? Okay. So why does he say it? It's very simple. Is that when the truth comes to you from whoever it is, within your framework or from outside of your framework, within your jama'ah or from outside of your jama'ah, you have to take it. Because that shows true commitment to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Shaykh Rabee, as Shaykh Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad said, he has done good work. You cannot deny that. And some of his opponents oppose him because of the good work he has done, because that good work goes against their framework. So you can argue that Shaykh Rabee's attitude, his language that he's using, his extrapolations and sometimes exaggerations are unpleasant, are not legitimate, and you would be right. However, if within all of that there is a certain truth that came from him that goes against your jama'ah, you have to accept that and re-question yourself and stick to that particular truth that reflects what is in the Quran and the Sunnah and abide by it. On the other hand of the spectrum, if you have gotten in this weird state of mind where, you know, Shaykh Rabee, he is on this level of the Quran and the Sunnah, in the sense that whatever jarh, tabdi', tahdhir, warning, whatnot comes from him, has the status of an ayah of the Quran that is unquestionable. Nobody has the right to verify it, verify his claims, verify the legitimacy of his ijtihad in the ruling that he made. No, people, you have gone far off. And here you hear, first of all, Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen has rejected that, and Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad. This is a recording, by the way, that is from the early 2000s. So it's like somewhere between 15 and 18 years ago. It's 2002, I believe, maybe 2004. Okay. So this is nothing new. And if you believe that your particular jama'ah are following or are aligned with what major scholars like Shaykh Al-Abbad, Shaykh Al-Fawzan, Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen are upon, well, how come these particular audios have never been presented to you? For those who happen to have stumbled over those audios, what has been done to you? What I've mentioned to you from Al-Imam Al-Shawkani. You have been given some far-fetched, weird explanation to say that, oh, but it doesn't apply, or, you know, because it's not specialized in manhaj, and blah, 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 blah. 1,001 ways to just escape the clear-cut speech and teaching from these major scholars. To conclude, I shall leave you with a golden piece of advice of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
وإنه من المؤسف في وقتنا الحاضر أن بعض الشباب اتخذ من بعض العلماء رموزا يقتدي بهم ويوالي من والاهم ويعادي من عاداهم ولو كان الذي عاداهم بحق والذي والاهم بغير حق وصاروا يتنازعون فيما بينهم ما تقول في فلان ما تقول في فلان لماذا أقول هذا فلان إن يخطئ ويصيب إن أخطأ وهو مجتهد فخطأه مغفور وإن أصاب فله أجران أما أن أوالي من والاه وأعادي من عاداه مهما كان الأمر فهذا لا يجوز. لذلك أدعو أبنائي الشباب أن لا يجعلوا هذا أكبر همهم، وأن لا يرفعوا بذلك رأسا، وأن يكون قصدهم الحق. من أي جهة أتى السمع إلى قول الله عز وجل: وإذا فعلوا فاحشة قالوا وجدنا عليها آباءنا والله أمرنا بها. قل إن الله لا يأمر بالفحشاء. كون احتجوا بحجتين: الأولى قولوا وجدنا عليها آباءنا، والثانية والله أمرنا بها. فقال الله عز وجل: قل إن الله لا يأمر بالفحشاء، وسكت عن الحجة الأولى. لماذا؟ لأن الحجة الثانية باطلة فأبطلها الله، والحجة الأولى صحيحة فسكت الله عنها وأقرها، مع أنها جاءت ممن يا جماعة؟ من المشركين. طيب، واستمع أيضا إلى ما صح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أنه أتاه حبر من أحبار اليهود وقال: يا محمد، إننا نجد أن الله يجعل السماء على إصبع والأرضين على إصبع، وذكر بقية الحديث. فضحك النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم حتى بدت نواجذه أو أنيابه تصديقا لقول الحبر، ثم قرأ: وما قدر الله حق قدره والأرض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامة والسماوات مطويات بيمينه سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. فهنا هل النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أنكر الحق لأن قائله غير محق أو لا؟ نجيبوا جماعة، لا، بل أقره مع أنه من يهودي. أبلغ من ذلك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم استحفظ أبا هريرة رضي الله عنه على صدقة الفطر، يعني قال: احرسها. في ليلة من الليالي أتى شخص على صورة إنسان فأخذ من الطعام، فأمسكه أبو هريرة وقال: لأرفعنك إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، أنه فقير ويعيا. فرق له أبو هريرة وأطلقه، ثم أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فقال له: ما فعل أسيرك البارحة؟ قال: يا رسول الله، ادعى أنه فقير وذو عيال فأطلقته. فقال: إنه كذب وسيعود. كذبت يعني أخبرك بالكذب وسيعود. يقول: فعلمت أنه سيعود بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسيعود. عاد في الليلة الثانية وأخذ من الطعام وادعى أنه ذو عيال وأنه فقير فأطلقه، لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم لما قال له سيعود لم يقل فاحبسه أو أمسكه. ثم أتى أبو هريرة إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فأخبره الخبر فقال: كذبك وسيعود. فعاد في الليلة الثالثة فأمسكه أبو هريرة وقال: لا بد أن أرفعك إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. فقال له هذا الشخص: ألا أدلك على آية من كتاب الله؟ إذا قرأتها لم يزل عليك من الله حافظ ولا يقربك شيطان حتى تصلي. فأطلق النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فأخبره فقال: صدقك وهو كذوب. إيش معنى صدقك؟ يعني أخبرك بالصدق، إنك إذا قرأت آية الكرسي لم يزل عليك من الله حافظ ولا يقربك شيطان حتى تصبح. ثم قال: أتدري ما من تخاطب منذ 3 ليال؟ قال لا أدري يا رسول. قال ذلك الشيطان. فانظر كيف قبل النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى وسلم الحق ممن؟ من الشيطان. فالمقصود الحق، ويعرف الرجال بالحق، وليس الحق يعرف بالرجال. طيب، إذن كيف نتفرق وتختلف القلوب من أجل الخصومة في شخص من العلماء؟ هذا يقول أنه محق وأنه على صواب، والثاني يقول بالعكس. هذا غلط، ليس من هدي الخلفاء الراشدين ولا الصحابة أيضا. الواجب قبول الحق من أي أحد قال به، ورد الباطل من أي أحد قال به. ثم لا يجوز أبدا أن نجعل الولاء والبراء مقيدا بأشخاص، لأن المرأة المعصومين يخطئون ويصيبون. فلنتفق ولندع هؤلاء الأشخاص ونسأل الله لهم الهداية إن كانوا أحياء، والمغفرة إن كانوا قد اجتهدوا فخالفوا الحق. وأمرهم إلى من؟ إلى من؟ إلى الله عز وجل. أما أن نفرق جمعنا ونشتت شملنا ونلقي العداوة بيننا من أجل الانتصار لهذا الشخص أو لهذا، فهذا غلط، هذا غلط محض وضرر كبير. لذلك أدعو إخواني المسلمين في كل مكان إلى الاتفاق وعدم الاختلاف، وأن لا يجعلوا من الأشخاص رموزا يوالون عليها ويعادون عليها، فإن هذا من الغلط. وما ضر المسلمين سابقا ولاحقا إلا هذا التعصب للأشخاص.